Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Arun Singh Thakur from Punjab University, Chandigarh. Today, we are going to discuss about the module Indian Tourism Scenario and various laws related to tourism and hospitality industry from the paper Tourism and Hospitality Entrepreneurship and Legal Environment. This module deals with describing brief about the initiatives taken by Ministry of Tourism, Government of India and various laws governing the tourism and hospitality industry in India. After studying this module, you will be able to explain the current status of Indian tourism industry along with initiatives taken by Ministry of Tourism, Government of India. Know the framework guidelines suggested by United Nations World Tourism Organization for framing tourism laws. List down the various laws governing hospitality industry in India. Then understand laws providing tax structure in tourism industry. And finally, know about the national tourism policy and regulations for the classification of the hotels in India. So let us start. Tourism and hospitality industry is one of the fastest growing industry in the world, which accounts for major source of revenue generation for the countries. The United Nations World Tourism Organization forecast average growth rate of 4% in the international tourism up to the year 2020. The main factors of tourism industry includes accommodation industry, restaurants, MICE, theme parks and cruises, etc. Tourism industry is a multi-billion dollar industry which depends upon disposable income, leisure time, attractions as major motivators. Being a global nature of tourism industry, there are diversified laws which governs the operations of the industry. As per the economic impact report issued by World Travel and Tourism Council, the direct contribution of travel and tourism to the gross domestic product worldwide in 2013 was US$2,155.4 billion, 2.9% of the GDP. Travel and tourism industry is expected to add more than 70 million jobs over the next decade, with two-thirds of those jobs to be created in Asia only. In India alone, the total market size of tourism and hospitality industry stood at US$117 billion in 2011 and anticipated to touch US$418.9 billion by 2022. The success of the hotel industry in India is second only to China in the entire Asia Pacific. Further, India is a developing global business hub which offers attractive investment propositions for both luxury and moderate tier hotels. India is projected to be number one for growth globally in the wellness tourism sector in the next 5 years, clocking over 20% gains annually through 2017. With opportunities aplenty, the future of the hotel industry in India looks very promising. Now students will discuss the Indian tourism scenario. The Ministry of Tourism is the apex body responsible to regulate the tourism industry in India. Below are the key developments in the Indian tourism scenario cited by Ministry of Tourism along with few other observations. As tourism is a major engine of economic growth and an important source of foreign exchange earnings in many countries including India. It has great capacity to create large-scale employment of diverse kind, from the most specialized to the unskilled, and hence can play
a major role in creation of additional employment opportunities. It can also play an important role in achieving growth with equity. The Ministry of Tourism has the main objective of increasing and facilitating tourism in India. Augmenting tourism infrastructure, easing of visa regime, assurance of quality standards in services of tourism service providers, etc., are some of the responsibilities of the ministry. The year 2016 witnessed a growth of 10.7% in foreign tourist arrivals in India. Foreign tourist arrivals during 2016 were 88.9 lakhs, and that figure is provisional as compared to the foreign tourist arrivals of 80.3 lakhs during 2015. The foreign exchange earnings from tourism in rupees during 2016 were rupees 1,55,650 crores with a growth of approximately 15.1%. Facilitative visa regime is a prerequisite for increasing inbound tourism. The Ministry of Tourism takes the initiative of pursuance with Ministry of Home Affairs and Ministry of External Affairs for achieving the same. As on 31st December 2016, the e-visa facility is available under three subcategories, that is e-tourist visa, e-business visa and e-medical visa. E-visa facility has been extended now to the nationals of 161 countries that covers almost entire globe. Then for providing information relating to travel and tourism in India to the domestic and international tourist visitors and for assisting them with advice while traveling in India, a 24/7 toll-free multilingual tourist info helpline in 10 international languages besides Hindi and English is being run by Ministry of Tourism. The calls made by tourists, both international and domestic, while in India will be free of charge. This service will be available on the number 1-800-111-363 or on a short code 1363. The international languages handled are Arabic, French, German, Italian, Japanese, Korean, Chinese, Portuguese, Russian and Spanish in addition to English and Hindi.
The Ministry of Tourism in its report further stated that setting in place the framework for supply of trained manpower is a challenge facing the hospitality education. It has been the endeavor of the Ministry of Tourism to put in place a system of training and professional education with necessary infrastructure support capable of generating manpower sufficient to meet the need of tourism and hospitality industry, both quantitatively and qualitatively. As of now, there are 42 institutes of hotel management, IHMs, comprising 21 central IHMs and 21 state IHMs and 10 food craft institutions, FCIs, which have come up with the support of ministry. These institutions were set up as autonomous societies with the specific mandate to impart hospitality education, conduct training in hospitality skills, while the IHMs mainly impart degree level hospitality education. The food craft institutes are concerned with skill level education. National Council for Hotel Management and Catering Technology, NCHMCT, steers and regulates the academic efforts of the IHMs and food craft institutes. The Ministry of Tourism has launched an initiative for providing preloaded SIM cards to the foreign tourists arriving in India on e-visa. This initiative has been launched on the 15th of February 2017 in association with Bharat Sanchar Nigam Limited, BSNL, where BSNL would distribute preloaded SIM cards to the foreign tourists on e-visa. This facility will be initially available in Indira Gandhi International Airport, Terminal 3, New Delhi, and later in the remaining 15 international airports where e-visa facility is currently available. This initiative is aimed at providing connectivity to the foreign tourists to enable them to stay in touch with their family and friends, and also help them to contact with the 24/7 multilingual toll-free helpline of Ministry of Tourism for any assistance and guidance during their times of distress or medical emergency, etc. A National Medical and Wellness Tourism Board have been set up to work as an umbrella organization to govern and promote medical tourism in India. The contribution to the gross domestic production of Indian tourism and hospitality sector is expected to grow at 7.8% per annum during the period 2013 to 2023. Government of India permitted 100% foreign direct investment in the accommodation industry. Due to the result of that, investment in this segment are also picking up with a very fast pace. In the recent years, accommodation industry took a shift towards budget and mid-range hotels. Renowned hotel companies have launched their brands, for example, Ginger by Indian Hotels, IHCL, catering to the budget and mid-market customers, who were thus far being served by the unorganized sector previously. Investment Information and Credit Rating Agency, ICRA, estimates 8 to 13% growth in the revenues for the industry over the next 3 years, with growth picking up in line with microeconomic outlook for the country, leading to mobilization of travelers and pickup in foreign tourist arrivals. The Government of India increased revenue on advertising campaigns like Incredible India. The Tourism Ministry has envisaged a budgetary allocation of rupees 200 billion in the 12th five-year plan in the near term, despite an anticipated revival in room demand. Hotels will not be able to hike annual rate of returns significantly, as the expected additions on the room inventory will intensify competition. India and Atithi Devo Bhava, to emphasize the rich variety of the tourism in India, are certain campaigns.
Now students further will discuss what is called as tourism law, the general government regulations on specific regulations enacted by government to regulate tourism and hospitality industry are referred to as tourism law. It also refers to a combination of central, state and international laws for the effective functioning of travel industry. These laws are also called as guiding principles for the business people as well as for the consumers in order to protect their rights. The United Nations World Tourism Organization and tourism laws. There are many common day-to-day travel-related problems that are addressed by various tourism legislations. For some tourists, even a lost or maybe a damaged baggage is a very serious issue. Thus, airlines should be made responsible for such negligence, thereby enforcing financial and legal liabilities under certain laws. Every country has their own laws for regulation of tourism industry and its various stakeholders. Considering the global nature of the tourism industry, it automatically became the responsibility of United Nations World Tourism Organization for enacting certain international laws and issuing guidelines for national law framework. The laws governing tourism tend to be disorganized and non-standardized. However, every tourism law attempts to protect travel consumers and organizations. According to United Nations World Tourism Organization, tourism laws can be made effective when consensus for tourism legislation is brought through following steps. The first, consistency with the national development policy. Then, consistency with the national tourism policy. Then, there should be a review of existing legal regulations governing tourism development and a review existing classification guidelines which affect the quality of existing tourism facilities and services and identify gaps and constraints. Then, to identify core legal issues, also to identify stakeholder groups. Then further, to identify the range of legal tools available and address the issue of enforcement, then build in quality assurance and foster professionalism, then facilitate business development. Then further is to identify the roles and responsibilities of various government agencies at central and local level in tourism development. Then organize a series of workshops at the regional level with all the stakeholders to identify current gaps and constraints in legislation related to tourism planning, development, management, and promotion. Then also to organize a national conference to disseminate the draft tourism law to all stakeholders to obtain their feedback and endorsement. And finally, formulate an implementation plan for the enforcement of the tourism law. Based on these, formulate a draft tourism law for the sustainable development, management, and regulation of the tourism industry, determining the rights and obligations of the government in terms of protecting natural and cultural resources and tourism development and management, the rights and the obligation of the industry suppliers, and the rights and obligation of the consumers.
Now, we'll discuss the various laws governing the hospitality business. The majority of the legislation governing the hospitality and hotel industry can be divided into three main sectors. The first head is the legislation for the construction and commissioning of the hotels, restaurants, guest houses, and other establishments, and includes Foreign Exchange Management Act, the industrial licensing policies, the land laws, and various development control orders issued by the central and state governments. The second head has legislation for the operation, maintenance, and management of establishments, food and hygiene standards. It also includes insurance laws, fire safety and weights and measure regulations. Further, various licenses such as liquor license, dance license, lodging house license, eating house license, police permissions, a license under Shops and Establishment Act or a license under the Food and Drug Administration Act granted on annual basis. The third head has rules regarding taxation, employment, and other contractual relationships. This includes law on income tax, service tax, expenditure law, excise duty, luxury tax, entertainment tax, as well as the laws on employment matters like apprentice law, ESI Act, etc. Some of the important licenses required by the hotels under the various acts are police license, oblique registration, the license under the Shops and Establishment Act, license under Prevention of Food and Adulteration Act, registration under the Luxury Tax Act, registration under the Sales Tax Act, registration under the Contract Labor Act, registration under the Pollution Control Act, then registration under the Provident Fund Act, registration under the ESI Act, entertainment license on festival occasions, license for chimney under the Smoke Nuisance Act, registration under the Weights and Measurement Act, factory license for laundry, central excise license for bakery products, registration and permit under the Motor Vehicle Act for tourist coaches and taxis, eating house license, then municipal beer bar license, then license for storage of diesel oil, license for storage of kerosene and compressed gas, including LPG, license to deal in foreign exchange under FEMA, coal store license if it is over 25 cubic feet, then license for boiler and generators and mixers and grinders, bar license specifically for foreign liquor, building completion certificate, copyright license for playing of music, lodging house license, approval from the Department of Tourism, Government of India, as per the property and the business the hotel is running.
Now, we'll have the description of some important laws related to tourism and hospitality industry. The first is the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act. It is a central government act enacted to protect the public from poisonous and harmful foods, prevent the sale of substandard foods, protect the interest of consumers by eliminating fraudulent practices. Second law is Food Safety and Standards Act. The Act deals with the following. 1. Establishment of the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, which lays down scientific standards relating to articles of food and regulates the manufacture, storage, distribution, sale and import of the food articles and ensuring the availability of safe and wholesome food for human consumption and for matters connected therewith or incidental thereto. The Legal Metrology Act. This act was enacted to establish and enforce standards of weights and measures, regulate trade and commerce in weights, measures and other goods which are sold or distributed on weight and measure or number. The fourth one is the Copyrights Act. It is a central legislation to protect rights related to literary, dramatic, musical, artistic, architectural work, etc. Hotels have to take license under this act to organize plays, musical shows or any other event. The another law related to tourism and hospitality industry is the Foreign Exchange Management Act, FEMA. It is an act passed in the winter session of Parliament in 1999. It replaced Foreign Exchange Regulation Act, that is FERA. This act seeks to make offences related to foreign exchange civil offences. The another law is the State-Specific Shops and Establishment Statutes. These legislations have been enacted to provide statutory obligation and rights to the employees and employers in the unorganized sector of employment, that is, shops and establishments. It is applicable to all persons employed in an establishment with or without wages, except the members of the employer's family. It is a state legislation and each state has framed its own rules for the act. The state government can exempt either permanently or for a specific period and establishments from all or any provisions of this Act. The Act provides for compulsory registration of shop establishment within 30 days of commencement of work and all communication of closure of an establishment within 15 days from its closing. It also lays down the hours of work per week, per day, as well as the guidelines for spread over, rest interval, opening and closing hours, closed days, national and religious holidays, overtime work, etc.
The next important regulation is the Air Act of 1981, that is for prevention and control of pollution. This Act has been enacted to provide the prevention and control and abatement of air pollution for the establishment with the view to carry out the aforesaid purpose of boards for conferring on and assigning to such boards the powers and functions relating thereto and for matters conducted therewith. It is a central government law. Other is the hotel insurance policies. Hotel insurance is specifically designed to meet the growing requirement of the hotel industry. Customized hotel insurance can be arranged to cover all types of establishments, be it spas, ranches, guest houses, bed and breakfast, that is B&Bs, or apartments. Hotel insurance caters to every kind of establishment. A standard hotel insurance policy includes protection against perils such as builder's risk, fire and accident damage and natural calamities. Other types of coverage such as liquor liability are a part of policy casualty portion.
Now further, we'll discuss about the taxation laws. According to the details compiled by the National Judicial Academy, following laws relating to tax structure in the tourism industry applies. The first one is Income Tax Act of 1961. It is a tax on income imposed by the central government. Residents in India are taxed on their worldwide income. Non-residents are taxed on Indian source of income. The Indian tax rates applicable to non-residents could be up to a minimum of 40%, that is, in case of foreign companies, excluding applicable surcharge and education. If the tax payable by any company, including a foreign company, taxable in India is less than 18.5% of its book profits, it will be required to pay minimum alternate tax. Interest received by a non-resident from Indian on foreign currency denominations loan may be taxable. Payments towards royalty and fee for technical services are taxable. Then the important tax is value added tax. Sales tax or VAT are levied by the states on the sale of goods within its territory. VAT is levied on value added at each stage in the production and distribution process of goods and services. All hotels that exceed the annual registration threshold have to be registered for VAT. VAT is levied on hotels' bills pertaining to lodging, food, telephone, tours, etc. After the implementation of the VAT, hotel tax is abolished and therefore hotels don't have to register for hotel tax. The rates of the VAT differ from state to state. The general rate of the VAT applicable on food and beverages in restaurants is 14.5%. The next tax is Sen VAT, duty imposed by the central government on manufacture of goods. Sen VAT is imposed at 12% with lower rate applicable in certain cases.
The other law is service tax. Under the current service tax regime, all services taxable unless exempt. General rate of service tax is 12.36%. Service tax on hotel accommodation is payable at 7.42%. Service tax on food and beverages is chargeable at 4.94% in restaurants with air conditioning. Food served in hotel room for their air-conditioned restaurants with liquor license will not attract service tax. SenVAT credit is available for the provider of taxable output services. Then expenditure tax. Expenditure tax in India is regulated by Expenditure Tax Act of 1987. This act shall apply in relation to any chargeable expenditure incurred in hotel wherein the room charges for any unit of residential accommodation at the time of incurring of such expenditure or incurred in restaurants are 1,200 rupees or more per day per individual and where a composite charge is payable in respect of such unit and food. The room charges included therein shall be determined in the prescribed manner. 1. A composite charge is payable in respect of such unit, food, drinks and other services or any of them and the case is not covered by the provision of subclause. A. It appears to the assessing officer that the charges for such unit, food, drinks and other services are so arranged that the room charges are understated and other charges are overstated. And number two, incurred in a restaurant, rate of tax is 20% and is collected by the central government.
The latest taxation law introduced, that is GST, India is all set to implement goods and services tax from 1st July 2017, which is said to have replaced all the existing taxation laws we have discussed previously. Hospitality industry is a versatile field encompassing accommodation and entertainment services, accounting, food and beverage, event management, and above all, guest satisfaction. With that, there comes an imperative need for the industry to walk hands in hand with the latest updates of the market and seek all-inclusive technology solutions which can help them in governing their hotels and restaurants effectively. Wider the utility, greater the exposure towards taxation and other compulsions from the government authorities. Along these lines, the Indian hospitality industry gives way to heaps of levied taxes and scores of highly paid services. So, as India warms up for GST, the hospitality industry should get ready with the GST compliant hotel software. The impact of GST will go far and wide, enabling everyone, right from the manufacturer and a supplier to distributor and consumer, to give their part of improving the country's economy. We'll try to understand the need for GST in India. According to the current indirect taxation scenario running in India, the state government imposes VAT, luxury and entertainment tax, entry tax and taxes on betting and gambling, whereas the central government levies taxes, duties of excise, service tax, custom duty and central state tax. This shows that for goods produced or manufactured within the country and then consumed later on, VAT is computed on a value which includes excise duty, and with different government imposing them, the credit of VAT is not available against excise and vice versa. This leads to a high cost and inefficient tax structure prone to revenue leakages. Then, the need for a comprehensive indirect tax structure came up, giving way to goods and services tax, that is GST. So, a short while ago, the government of India passed the long overdue GST bill, taking the whole country in a wave of extracting the corresponding act and reforms. Similar to Canada, India will have a dual GST model, whereas the tax will be administered by the central as well as the state government, Brazil being the only other country to adopt dual GST model for a sale within the state, SGST, that is state GST, and CGST, central GST, will be applied, whereas for the sale outside the state is IGST, that is integrated GST, will be levied. The central GST and integrated GST will be collected by the central government and state GST by the state government. Along with this, the GST Council has narrowed down on a four-tier tax structure of 5, 12, 8 and 28%, such that 12 and 18% will accommodate most of the goods and services. Impact analysis of GST. What does it bring for the Indian hospitality industry? The impact of GST on hotel and tourism industry will be important, as this sector was already under stress after demonetization and the hope was high from GST. How recent have you been to a hotel, or when was the last time you flew? Well, our concern is about taxes. You have been paying these on services. Have you ever been looked at your hotel receipt or flight tickets for luxury taxes and other charges? We guess not. The following details will help you to understand the taxes you have been paying to date and the impact of the GST on the hotel and tourism industry after 1st July 2017, the rollout date for the GST. In the current indirect tax regime, the hospitality industry is plagued by multiple taxes of service tax, VAT, and luxury tax, eventually being a victim of tax overtax. The GST with rate of 18% will subsume all of these taxes and bring them under one single entity. Moreover, it will help to reduce multiple taxation by giving a significant boost to the hospitality and tourism industry. Presently, the centrally administered service tax is levied at 9% in the hotel industry and 6% in the food and beverage industry. Besides that, the luxury tax and VAT are state dependent. The states which apply luxury tax on rack rates, like Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, Delhi, and Andhra Pradesh, and those states which have high luxury taxes like Kerala, have a total tax summed up to 19 to 25%. Suffice to say that effect of GST will be positive, leading to considerable reduction of 3.5 to 7% in taxes respectively, whereas the states will levy lower tax rates like Maharashtra. The impact of GST will be fairly neutral, with total tax as 19%, resulting in the reduction of 1% tax. Additionally, the food and beverage sector is going to have a neutral to marginally positive impact due to GST, owing to the high abatement rate of 60% in the sector. The overall tax comes close to 18.5% to 20.5%. Currently, reducing it by 0.5% to 2.5% under GST. The GST of 18% will thus lead to banquets becoming reasonable, consequently offering huge haul to the hospitality industry. However, alcohol is said to be outside the purview of GST, varying from state to state as per the current scenario. So, the major impact of GST will fall on banqueting, wherein the effective tax comes up to 23 to 35%, following the luxury tax applied by selected state governments. Current rates of taxes. Hotel and tourism industry in India comprise of many taxes as well as cascading of taxes. The major taxes of the industry that can be clearly seen on any receipt of registered hotel. These are VAT, luxury taxes and service tax. The VAT varies from state to state and lies between 12 to 14.5%. Similarly, luxury tax depend on the proportion of room tariff and usually scales between 0 to 12%. Service taxes are the ones that fluctuates. It depend on the type of service that has been rendered or ordered. It is usually valued at 8.7% of the total room tariff. Food rate varies from place to place and so does it bill or tax. Food and beverage, 40% of the bill attracts the service tax and it comes to 5.8% when considered in the total bill. For booking in hotels, for occasions like marriages, ceremonies and meetings, an abatement of 30% are given and the effective service tax works out to 10.15% on the total charges. Now we'll discuss what are the advantages of GST for the hotel and tourism industry. Better utilization of input tax credit, as there is uniformity of taxes under GST, there will be clarity for the customers. It is time saving. Apart from the advantages discussed above, there are certain disadvantages of GST on hotel and tourism sectors, which include increased cost, competition from Asian market, as the tax rates are less in the countries like Singapore, Malaysia and China.
Further, we'll discuss about national policy and regulatory agencies. First is the National Tourism Policy of 2002. In order to develop tourism in India in a systematic manner, position it as a major engine of economic growth and to harness its direct and multiplier effects of employment and poverty eradication in an environmentally sustainable manner, the National Tourism Policy was formulated in the year 2002, broadly called as policy attempts to, number one, position tourism as a major engine of economic growth, harness the direct and multiplier effect of tourism for employment generation, economic development and providing impetus to rural tourism, then focus on domestic tourism as a major driver of tourism growth, then position India as a global brand to take advantage of the burgeoning of global travel trade and the vast untapped potential of India as a destination. Acknowledge the critical role of the private sector, with government working as a proactive facilitator and catalyst. Then, to create and develop integrated tourism circuits based on India's unique civilization, heritage, and culture in partnership with states, private sector, and other agencies, and ensure that the tourist to India gets physically, mentally rejuvenated, culturally enriched, spiritually elevated, and feel India from within.
Now, the scheme for product or infrastructure and destination development. The focus under this scheme is on improving the existing products and developing new tourism products to world-class standards. Scheme for integrated development of tourist circuits. Under this central financial assistance scheme, the Ministry of Tourism, Government of India has been extending assistance to states for development of tourism infrastructure. Experience has shown that in the past, funds under CFA, that is Central Financial Assistance Scheme, have been used to fund a large number of small isolated projects spreading throughout the country, resulting in the resources being spread very thinly. Therefore, in order to provide quick and substantial impact during the 10th five-year plan, these new schemes of integrated development of tourist circuits have been taken up. The objective of the scheme is to identify tourist circuit in the country on annual basis and develop them to international standards. The aim is to provide all infrastructure facilities required by the tourist within these circuits. The Ministry of Tourism aim at convergence of resources and expertise through coordinated action with states and union territories and private sector. Scheme for assistance for large revenue generating projects. It is recognized that the development of tourism infrastructure projects requires very large investment that may not be possible out of the budgetary resources of the Government of India alone. In order to remove these shortcomings and to bring in private sector, corporate and institutional resources as well as the techno-managerial efficiencies, it is proposed to promote large revenue gathering projects for development of tourism infrastructure in public partnerships and in partnership with the other governments or semi-government agencies. Large revenue generating project which can be admissible for assistance under this scheme should be a project which is also a tourist attraction or used by tourists and generates revenue through a levy of fee or user charge on the visitors. Projects like tourist trains, cruise vessels, cruise terminals, convention centers and golf courses etc. would qualify for assistance. However, this is only an illustrative list. Hotel and restaurant component will not be eligible for assistance under the scheme either on a stand-alone basis or an integrated part of some other project. Besides hotel and restaurants, procurement of vehicles and sports facilities like stadiums will also not be eligible for assistance under the scheme. Now students will discuss one committee, that is Hotel and Restaurant Approval Classification Committee, HRACC. Hotel and Restaurant Approval Classification Committee is responsible for the affiliation, classification and functioning of hotels in India. Following are the functions performed by HRACC as per its statutes. It inspects and assesses establishments based on the facilities and services offered. The Department of Tourism grants star status based on how well the establishment scores in the HRACC report, that is 90% 5-star deluxe, 75% 4-star, 65% 3-star, 55% 2-star and 50% for 1-star hotels. Food Authority assesses matters relating to Food and Safety Standards Act 2006 to regulate and monitor the infrastructure, processing, distribution, sale and import of food so as to ensure the safe and wholesome food. The Federation of Hotel and Restaurant Association of India, FERHAI, is also a regulating authority. The Ministry of Tourism is the nodal authority and along with the Department of Tourism, it is responsible for promotion, policies and regulation of hospitality industry, particularly hotels. The Ministry, in order to develop tourism in India in a systematic manner, to facilitate investment both from foreign and domestic market into the sector, has made several policy announcements and incentives. The most important being the National Tourism Policy of 2002, which aims positioning India as a global brand to take advantage of the burgeoning global travel trade and the vast untapped potential of India as a destination. Keenly aware of the unfolding boom in the tourism industry, the Indian government is lending a hand to the growth of the industry. To boost the tourism of various kinds in India, the Tourism Ministry has recently launched a campaign called Incredible India in order to encourage different types of tourism in India. Foreign direct investment in this sector is permitted up to 100% on the automatic route. The following are some of the important guidelines issued by Department of Tourism. Approval of hotels at project stage and classification and reclassification of hotels. guidelines for classification of heritage hotels, timeshare resorts, standalone restaurants, then guidelines for apartment hotels, guidelines for approval of guest houses, hospitality development and promotion board, ensure timely accrual of approvals, clearance, NOCs by the multiple agencies and facilitate implementation of the hotel projects, then expeditious clearance will be enabled in completion of the hotel projects, in time landing to enhancement of room availability for the tourist, implementing a transparent system for the effective monitoring of the hotel projects.
So, the students, let us now summarize what we have learned in this module. According to the United Nations World Tourism Organization, the purpose of travel legislation is to provide a regulatory framework for the proper development and management of the tourism activities. Ideally, this will aid the conservation and natural resources and the preservation of cultural traditions. As an added benefit, travel consumers and organizations receive basic legal protection. However, creating and enforcing tourism laws is notably tax around the world. Certain developing countries have not only weak travel infrastructures but offer zero resources or protection to non-local visitors. Understandably, popular countries also struggle to monitor and enforce laws to protect tourists because the sheer number of visitors and unsurplus business people who target tourists. An international airline can infringe the rights of traveling passengers, being considered as a weaker section, a customer as compared to the airline. There are laws which empower customer to take legal course of action for making his loss good. Thank you.